Hey Satish, how are you doing?
I'm doing all right, but a little stressed. Everybody these days is using this foundation model thingy, and I'm trying to understand how it applies to medical imaging.
I see. I recently discovered this app. It's actually pretty good. It explains the concepts very well, and it also has practical examples.
Wow.
Do you want to check it out?
Yes, absolutely. Anything that makes this easier to understand, yes.
Okay.
Ready to learn about foundation models and their application in medical imaging?
Absolutely, I really need help to understand this.
Sure, let's dive in. Foundation models are large-scale AI models trained on vast amounts of data designed to be adaptable for various tasks. These models promise to revolutionize fields like natural language processing, autonomous driving, and, of course, medical image analysis. They are built using deep learning techniques, particularly built on deep neural networks and trained via self-supervised learning.
What makes these foundation models so special compared to traditional models?
Foundation models are general-purpose technologies that support a diverse range of use cases or tasks, unlike traditional models, which are typically designed for one specific task only.
What exactly is self-supervised learning?
Self-supervised learning, or SSL, leverages vast amounts of unlabeled data to learn from the inherent structure in the data. Unlike supervised learning, which depends on labeled datasets, SSL learns via a pretext task. A pretext task is an auxiliary task designed to generate supervisory signals from unlabeled data, enabling the model to learn useful data representations. These tasks are constructed in such a way that solving them requires the model to understand important aspects of the data structure.
Can you explain how SSL works with foundation models?
Absolutely. Let's dive into specific SSL techniques categorized into discriminative and generative schemes. Discriminative SSL techniques focus on distinguishing between different data samples and match different views of the same sample to learn robust representations. Let's check some popular choices to do this. SIMCLR focuses on using contrastive learning. It takes different augmented views of the same image and makes the model learn to recognize them as similar while distinguishing them from other images considered as negative samples. The use of data augmentations like cropping, color jittering, and grayscale transformations helps the model learn invariant features.
Are negative samples and a large batch necessary for SSL?
Good question. BYOL, or bootstrap your own latent, avoids the need for negative samples and self-supervised learning. Unlike contrastive methods like SIMCLR, BYOL trains using only positive pairs through a dual network architecture that includes an online and a target network. The online network learns to predict the target network's representation of the same image under a different augmentation. The target network is updated as an exponential moving average of the online network, promoting consistent learning without contrasting against negatives. Additionally, as they are updated differently, their state is slightly different, preventing learning collapse. This method is particularly advantageous for modalities like X-rays, where defining strictly distinct negative examples is challenging due to the subtle and complex variations in medical images. Another important discriminative method is SWAV, swapping assignments between views. SWAV learns by clustering the data and swapping the cluster assignments between different augmented views of the same image. This method allows the model to learn robust features by maximizing the agreement between different views without requiring negative samples. SWAV uses an online clustering mechanism where each image view is assigned to a cluster prototype, and these assignments are swapped between views to create consistency. Barlow Twins aims to ensure that the representations of two augmented versions of an image are similar while minimizing redundancy in the learned features. It introduces a loss function that measures the cross-correlation matrix between these two sets of representations and penalizes any off-diagonal values that are non-zero. This means the model learns to produce representations that are not only invariant to the augmentations, but also decorrelated, capturing a wide range of information from the input images.
How does minimizing redundancy help the model?
By minimizing redundancy, Barlow Twins encourages the model to learn diverse and informative features. This way, each dimension of the representation captures unique aspects of the image, leading to richer and more useful embeddings for downstream tasks. Next, let's check DINO, which stands for Distillation with No Labels. It follows a similar paradigm as BYOL, as it uses a teacher and student to learn data representations without labels. In DINO, only the student model is trained, while the teacher model is constructed as a moving average of the student's parameters. This setup harnesses the student's learning trajectory as a continuous source of accumulated knowledge. Something very important in DINO is the way augmentations take place. DINO also uses augmentations to generate different views that are then contrasted, just like BYOL does. But differently, DINO uses two sizes of crop augmentations defined as cutouts larger than 50% of the image or smaller than 50%. These are referred to as global and local views. During training, the teacher network only sees global views while the student network sees both. This aims at encouraging representations with a local to global correspondence. The representations from these views are contrasted using the cross-entropy loss. To this end, softmax operations are used to convert representations into probability distributions, mimicking a classification problem. In addition, the teacher network also incorporates a centering and sharpening operation of the probability distributions. Centering normalizes the teacher's output distributions, and sharpening adjusts their sharpness to prevent trivial solutions. Together, centering and sharpening avoid collapse of learned representations and promote training stability. DINO enables learning of high-quality representations without labeled data, which is particularly useful in domains like medical imaging where labeled data is limited.
That makes sense. What about generative schemes?
Generative SSL techniques focus on generating new data points or reconstructing parts of the data to learn representations. Inpainting and data reconstruction tasks are common in medical imaging. Inpainting involves filling in missing parts of an image, which helps the model understand the context and structure of the data. Data reconstruction tasks require the model to reconstruct images from partial or noisy data, enhancing its ability to handle real-world imperfections. Let's discuss some popular methods. Masked autoencoders, MAE, focus on reconstructing the original image from a few patches. The model learns to predict the missing parts of the image, capturing the essential features and patterns. This technique is effective in medical imaging, where fine details are crucial for accurate diagnosis. It is worth mentioning that masked autoencoders fit particularly well with transformers since they can learn a long context from which to build the patches. BIT, or bidirectional encoder representation from image transformers, uses a self-supervised approach similar to masked autoencoders, but with a key difference. Instead of reconstructing the original pixel values, BIT predicts the underlying discrete tokens representing the masked regions using a pre-trained tokenizer. This approach enables the model to capture high-level semantic concepts rather than just low-level visual details. As a result, BIT is particularly effective for applications requiring a deep contextual understanding, such as natural language processing and complex scene understanding.
What about foundation models for medical image analysis?
Foundation models are powerful in medical imaging due to their ability to handle large, complex data sets. For example, MedClip uses contrastive learning to improve classification performance. MedClip leverages contrastive learning to align medical images and text reports. It was trained on a large and diverse dataset comprising over 600,000 of X-ray images and over 200,000 textual reports. Differently from Clip, proposed for natural images, MedClip takes advantage of unpaired image-only and text-only datasets by creating pseudo-pairs based on their semantic content. This process involves sampling combinations and measuring their semantic compatibility, thus effectively utilizing all available data types. In histopathology, CONC was proposed. It stands for contrastive learning from captions for histopathology. It uses diverse sources of histopathology images and biomedical text to pre-train on over 1.17 million image caption pairs. This approach allows Conch to excel in a wide range of downstream tasks, such as histology, image classification, segmentation, captioning, and text-to-image and image-to-text retrieval.
Is image and text always required?
Recently presented, RadDino introduces a biomedical image encoder pre-trained solely on unimodal biomedical imaging data. It achieves similar or greater performance compared to state-of-the-art biomedical language-supervised models on a diverse range of benchmarks. RadDino demonstrates that image-only supervision is a scalable approach for training a foundational biomedical image encoder, especially useful given the scarcity of paired imaging text data due to privacy concerns. Also recently presented, there's Foundation Arc, a framework designed to aggregate knowledge from numerous small public datasets. It accrues and reuses knowledge from heterogeneous expert annotations to train powerful and robust foundation models.
What are some challenges faced when applying these models to medical imaging?
Training foundational models demands immense computational power, vast datasets, and substantial financial and environmental costs. Adapting these models to specialized tasks also requires additional data, fine-tuning, and expertise. Second, biases and fairness remain critical concerns. When it comes to medical image applications, issues of fairness and bias become even more critical in healthcare, where inaccurate or biased results can have life-altering consequences. Ensuring the models are trained on diverse, high-quality medical datasets is essential. Addressing these challenges is vital to unlock the full potential of foundation models while ensuring their responsible and equitable use. It is also worth mentioning that more evidence is still needed to confirm that a foundation model, fine-tuned to a specific task, might outperform its equivalent fully supervised model trained specifically for the same task.
That's really helpful, Bender. I feel like I'm starting to get a hang of this already.
Me too. That was way easier with your explanations.
I'm glad I could help. By understanding their basics as well as their challenges, you can harness their full potential.
Thanks, Bender. This was great.
You're welcome. And until next time.